Take away the world's desire when we pray. Holy Spirit, lift us higher when we pray. When we pray, when we pray, let it not be for a season when we pray. Give us wisdom and not reason when we pray. Let your name be our petition when we pray.
And the power of his blood. I come before you, Lord, recognizing that you are supreme in authority. Your power is great in the heavens and the earth, and your anger is shown against all wickedness and the evil imagination of men. Father, I boldly approach your throne yet again, this time asking for grace and mercy for your bride, the church. Your word says that judgment shall begin at the house of God. So let the church bear the greatest indictment, because your invisible works are clearly seen, demonstrating your eternal power and divine nature. All men are without excuse. Yet through hypocrisy, we have given place to your enemies to blaspheme your great and holy name. Because of our perversion and deceitfulness, which brings shame to your name, they question whether we are really your children. For this cause, Lord, we are guilty and bear the greater burden. We have been weighed in the balance and been found wanting, yet we refuse to change our path. We have been deliberate in our great trespass before you, Lord, and we are not hidden from your sight. We have provoked you to anger with our foolish and unwise behavior, being spiritually blind and naked, allowing the world to see our shame. Heavenly Father, because you are a God of mercy and great compassion, we come before you in humility, that you may examine our ways. We come before you confessing that if we humble ourselves and pray, seek your face, and turn from our wicked ways, then will you hear from heaven, forgive our sins, and heal our land. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, we thank you, Heavenly Father, that your hands are not shortened, that they cannot save, nor your ear heavy, that it cannot hear. We stand before you, Lord, to answer the indictment that has been laid against us, and pray that through repentance our sins will be forgiven. For we have done wicked things in your sight, even rebellion against your commandments and your continued reminders and warnings. In the name of Jesus, we acknowledge our shortcomings and weaknesses, seeking to be washed in the blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. For we were called to be the salt of the earth, a people that would bear witness to your name, follow your examples, live by your commandments, and set a difference between that which is holy and that which is profane. Instead, our hearts have been pierced with the desires of the world, and we have adopted their ways, chasing after materialism and lust and compromising your standards. We have not sought you for who you are, but for what you can give and how much we can get. We have allowed worldliness into your church and created unholy alliances with the world, calling that which is evil good and that which is good evil, while refusing to take a righteous stand. We have sought validation from the world and coveted the admiration of men who have perverted your statutes for selfish gain. We have shown them all that is in your sanctuary, giving access to thieves and robbers who now make merchandise of your sheep and a mockery of your name. We have failed to protect the innocent, neglected the cries of the poor, and watched as families are being destroyed. We have not sanctified you in the eyes of the people, becoming powerless gift chasers who adorn the things on the outside while failing to address the evil within. We have compromised your word by seeking popularity and friendship with the world, choosing to entertain the masses with our talents and gifts while watering down your word and speaking fables instead of convicting people to change. We stand idle as the innocent are snatched from the womb while we defend the guilty, giving them place on your stage. We are consumed with the pursuit of wealth, while at the same time we are robbed of morality, dignity, and holiness. Through compromise and exploitation, we have lost our influence. Through sermonettes and motivational speeches, we have catered to itching ears. And through hypocrisy and double standards, our pulpits have been stripped of power and authority. We have even embraced the lifestyles of this world and distorted the meaning of your love instead of preaching the sovereign design and plan of God. We have lost our way, Lord, and given over the cares of this life. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, forgive us, Father, for we bombard your throne with selfish prayers while the world around us declines in decay, drifting further and further away from you. We have been mesmerized by the lust of the world and desensitized by its influences while engaging in unspeakable acts, adultery and fornication, abortions, drunkenness, promiscuity, hatred and insensitivity, drug use, blasphemies, idolatry, man lying with man, women lying with women. We defile ourselves by flooding our minds with pornography, immorality and lust, and other kinds of sexual perversion. We have neglected our children and not taught them your ways, putting success and riches before love and direction. We have allowed our marriages to grow cold, harbored unforgiveness, and refused to show affection, while opening the door for the enemy to wreak havoc in our families. We have become a lukewarm church, lacking holiness and obedience to your word, even denying your name, Lord, and abandoning the cross. We have allowed false prophets to operate in the church while embracing false gods and religions. We are in a backslidden state and confess our sins before you. We were all born into this world with something to surrender, but so many of us have refused to let go, choosing to embrace our fallen nature by making excuses for sin, as opposed to trusting your word for deliverance and healing. In doing so, we have denied the power of the cross and the delivering authority of your resurrection. We go down in the water, but never come up, sinking further and further into the depth you gave your life to conquer. We have titles without meaning, performances without actors, services without substance, and buildings that are lifeless when it comes to the real power of God. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, we repent, Lord, and ask for your forgiveness. Lord, let your anger and fury be held back, and let your mercy fall upon us as we repent of our wicked deeds and turn back to you. Let us once again be the people you have chosen to show yourself strong in the earth, that through our examples and trusting your word, the world will once again look to the church for salvation and demonstration of the true power of God. Lord, please hear our cry, incline thine ear, and behold our frail state, that we may eagerly approach your throne with boldness and have confidence at your appearing. Your word says that you will never leave or forsake us, and we come to you by faith, knowing that without faith it is impossible to please you. Deliver us from the guilt of the past and wipe away all condemnation, for through our sin we have given the enemy access to our lives and the legal right to carry out his diabolical plan of destruction against us. But now, Lord, through repentance, his rights have been revoked. In the name of Jesus, we denounce Satan and his demonic forces of evil and his rebellion against the kingdom of God. In the name of Jesus and the finished work of the cross, he loses all rights to torment, deceive, destroy, afflict, and manifest himself in the lives of your people. And we sever all ties, cooperation, agreement, conspiracy, and relationship with the world and the world system. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, we command Satan to loose every stronghold, demonic manifestation, false belief, vice, grip, addiction, spell, and curse right now according to the word of God. We choose you, Lord, and the finished work of the cross, and want no part of Satan and the temptations of this world. I declare right now that we are loosed in your precious name. Lord, we renew our covenant and commitment to you and exercise our choice to faithfully serve you with all of our heart, mind, body, soul, and spirit. In the name of Jesus, we make a conscious choice to turn back to you and once again follow after your statutes and commandments and pledge our undivided service and devotion to you. For we have been bought with a price, and serving you is our reasonable service. So help us, Lord, to be lights in this world, ambassadors of the Most High God, and instruments of righteousness, representing your will and not our own. I pray, Lord, that our hunger and thirst for you is never quenched, and that you give us both to will and to do your good pleasure, that we as a church may fulfill the calling and purpose that you have spoken over our lives. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, we denounce the pleasures of this world, false doctrine, and all forms of spiritual adultery. We pray that you expose the synagogue of Satan operating behind church walls, every lying and deceitful spirit, and demons operating as angels of light. Let us not worship or reverence anyone or anything but the true and living God, and drive out the spirit of Antichrist. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I pray that you remove all doubts and bring revelation to every distortion of the truth, and that we drive out the spirit of Jezebel that teaches fornication, lust, and idolatry. That her curse, seduction, and influence be broken and bound right now in the name of Jesus, and erased from the hearts and minds of your people. I ask, Lord, that the depths of Satan operating in the church be exposed and driven out in Jesus' name, that we no longer defile ourselves through the lust of the flesh and the pride of life, hating all evil, pride, arrogance, and the evil way. Grant us spiritual discernment that we are not deceived. Let us examine the fruit of a man and not be gift chasers led astray by talents, gifts, and charisma. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I pray that the church will once again be known for its good works, love, faith, dedication, patience, and compassion to all men. That we hate the sin but love the sinner, understanding that we have all fallen short of the glory of God. Let us love according to the word of God, standing on the truth, preaching the word in and out of season, and making no provision for the flesh, while understanding that grace is not an excuse for sin and a justification for heaven. Help us, Lord, to minister without compromise to those seeking the truth and be found without spot or wrinkle, boldly proclaiming the truth of Christ and the power of his resurrection. Let us live and reign with Christ, clothed with holiness and abiding in his presence through eternity. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I speak life into your church and come against all dead things. Let our branches bring forth fruit in their season, and our roots be nourished by the waters of life. Let us be called and set apart, chosen and faithful, serving as kings and priests in your kingdom, knowing that we are in the end times, that we be not lulled to sleep by the passing of days, nor deceived by scoffers who deny your coming, but that we are watchful, and that day does not overtake us as a thief in the night. We are pilgrims in the earth, and this is not our home. So we look forward to the rapture and second coming of Christ, having faith that the promises of God shall come to pass. In the name of Jesus, I pray that we hold fast to our belief that you are the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man cometh to the Father but by you, and that we never lose our boldness and passion for the Most High God. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I pray that we are not weary in well-doing, and that we have a desire to spend quality time in your word and in fellowship with you, that we neglect not the fellowshipping of the saints, as we are one in the body of Christ and sealed by the precious gift of the Holy Spirit, that we may all faithfully walk in the calling and purpose we have been given, pressing toward the mark and high calling of Jesus Christ our Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you are able to keep that which we have committed unto you against that day, and that nothing we have done is in vain, but all things are accounted to our heavenly account that we may be rich towards God. Lord, let us run this race with patience, looking unto you who has endured the cross and despised the shame for the joy that was set before you, that our names be confessed before the Father and written in the Lamb's book of life. I pray, Lord, that we are steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the love of God, that we may receive a crown of life promised to those who endure unto the end. Now unto God, who knows the beginning from the end, who is our shield in time of trouble, and who causes us to endure the fiery furnaces of life, we give you honor and praise. We proclaim and ascribe greatness to your name, for your deeds are perfect and all that you do is just and fair. You own the cattle on a thousand hills and cause darkness to flee in the presence of light. I pray, Lord, that we demonstrate our gratitude for all that you have done by keeping your commandments. For your word says obedience is better than sacrifice, and rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Let your word be a light unto our path, revelation in darkness, and our blueprint for all matters pertaining to this life and the one thereafter. It is through you, Heavenly Father, and the power of your might, that one could chase a thousand and two could put 10,000 to flight. For greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. These things I ask and pray and affirm in Jesus' great and holy name. Amen.
Amen.
And we just want to thank you for joining us right here on LPJ 64 with Mr. and Mrs. Sweet Thing Bible Study Hour. We want you to keep it locked in right here on LPJ. Well, we're going to start off with the Seven Seals, part two of the Seven Seals. All right. Hopefully you can hear us, because I can't even hear anything.
Well, I see what's happening here, I tell you.
The earphone, maybe.
Okay. Yeah. All right, go ahead. They hear you. Keep talking.
All right, so there.
Okay, it's one thing, it's another. Okay.
That's all right. We just want to thank you for joining us. It's always some kind of technical difficulty, but we got it. So again, if you listen to us Wednesday, we've done the Seven Seals. So we're doing the Seven Seals part two. And we was in Revelation chapter 6, verse 1 through 8. Now we're going to read part of those, and then we'll start off, I think, in 5, 6, and 7. Then I saw as the Lamb broke open one of the seven seals, and it as if in a voice of thunder, I heard one of the four living creatures call out, "Come." And I looked and saw there a white horse whose rider carried a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he rode forth, conquering and to conquer. And when he broke the second seal, I heard the second living creature call out. And another horse came out flaming red, and its rider was empowered to take the peace from the earth, so that men slaughtered one another, and he was given a huge sword. So the events of the seventh seal must be understood in the context of the Old Testament covenant curses, and they specified in terms of sword, famine, pestilence, and the wild beast. So Ezekiel calls them God's four severe judgments, and they were the disciplinary judgments by which God, seeking to awaken his people to their spiritual condition. So we talked about all that Wednesday. So we're going to move down here to, we've done the second and third seal. We're just giving you just a little glimpse of what we had talked about Wednesday. You can go back and check out Wednesday's Bible study talking about the beginning of the first, second, third, and fourth seal. We are going to do, okay, the opening of the fifth seal. Now we can go to 9, Revelation 6, stay in Revelation 6. We're going down to 9 and 10. When the Lamb broke open the fifth seal, I saw at the foot of the altar the souls of those whose lives had been sacrificed for adhering to the word of God and for the testimony they had borne. They cried in a loud voice, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long now before you will sit in judgment and avenge our blood upon those who dwell on the earth? So the word soul in the Bible denotes the whole person. The martyrdoms of God's faithful and persecuted people is portrayed here in terms of the sacrificial blood poured out at the base of the earthly sanctuary altar of sacrifice. Now you can read that in Exodus 29 and 12 and Leviticus 4 and 7. So God's people have suffered injustice and death for their faithfulness to the gospel. They cried out to God, asking him to step in to vindicate them. But these tests concern the injustice done here on earth. They are not saying anything about the state of the dead. So after all, these people do not appear to be enjoying the bliss of heaven. You got to remember that. They're not in heaven. So the scene of the fifth seal applies historically to the period leading up to and following the Reformation, during which millions were martyred because of their faithfulness. And you can read that in Matthew, go to Matthew 24 and 21. Matthew 24 and 21.
Okay.
You ready? For then there will be great tribulation, affliction, distress, and oppression, such as has not been from the beginning of the world until now, no, and never will be again. So it also brings to mind the experience of God's suffering people throughout history from the time of Abel in Genesis 14 until the time when God will finally avenge the blood of his servants. Oh, we look forward to that day.
Yes, we do.
So we're going to go to the opening of the sixth seal. So in the fifth seal, we see God's people suffering injustice in a hostile world. As they cried out for God's intervention on their behalf, the time has come for God to intervene in answer to the prayers of his people. Now we're going to go back to Revelation chapter 6. And we'll do 12 through 14. When he, the Lamb, broke open the sixth seal, I looked, and there was a great earthquake, and the sun grew black as sackcloth of hair. The full disk of the moon became like blood, and the stars of the sky dropped to the earth like a fig tree shedding its unripe fruit out of season when shaken by a strong wind. And the sky rolled up like a scroll and vanished. Every mountain and island was dislodged from its place. And then we're going to go to Matthew 24, because all those are line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little.
Remember? Well, a little bit there, a little bit over here, and put that's it all right. together, and you'll come up with what you choose.
That's right. Matthew 24, verse 29 and 30. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not shed its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of heaven will be shaken. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn and beat their breasts and lament in anguish. And they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Also, we're going to look in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 through 10. All this is being revealed in these scriptures. And to recompense you who are so distressed and afflicted, by granting you relief and rest along with us, your fellow sufferers, when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in a flame of fire, to deal out a retribution, chastisement, and vengeance upon those who do not know or perceive or become acquainted with God, and upon those who ignore and refuse to obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Such people will pay the penalty and suffer the punishment of everlasting ruin, destruction, and perdition, and external exclusion and banishment from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. When he comes to be glorified in his saints, on that day he will be made more glorious in his consecrated people, and he will be marveled at and admired in his glory reflected in all who have believed, who have adhered to, trusted in, and relied on him, because our witnessing among you was confidently accepted and believed. And so all those scriptures tell of Jesus Christ's return.
And look, I tell you, that is the day
that I look forward to.
Yes, many of us are waiting on and looking forward to.
Amen.
And waiting on. Can't wait. Can't wait on. Just say, Lord, when? Because when you look at the way this world is going now, and the way people are, the way their hearts are getting waxing and even more cold than what
yes, it
was.
Is.
It's like, Lord, when? You
right.
know, how much longer?
That's right.
You know, and he knows, because it's like, not now. If I came now, you're not ready. You
and
think
I'm
you
ready.
Are. You're not ready. So he's giving us time to get it ready. He's giving us time to get our hearts and soul and mind ready to go home with him. Because if he came now, we'd be...
Will we be ready?
No, we'd be in bad shape. We wouldn't be ready to go anywhere, but where we should
want to go. That's why we say he is long-suffering for us, and he does not want any of us to perish, but all to have everlasting life.
Yes, everlasting life. That's
right. Mm-hmm. The last three signs of the sixth seal were foretold by Jesus in Matthew 24, 29-30, what we read. They were to occur near the end of the Great Tribulation. Now we're going to look in Revelation again, but this time Revelation chapter 7 and verse 14.
All right.
I replied, Sir, you know, and he said to me, these are they who have come out of the great tribulation, persecution, and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. So in 1798, as the Avengers of the Second Coming, as with Christ's prophecy in Matthew 24, the sun, moon, stars, meteors, and sky are literally here. The use of the words as or like paints a picture of the actual thing or event. The sun became as black as sackcloth. The moon became like blood. The stars fell to the earth as fig trees drops its late figs. So the Christian in the Western world recognized the fulfillment of Jesus' words in the order of each of these signs. The Lisbon earthquake in 1755, the dark day of May 1780 experienced in eastern New York and southern New England, and a spectacular meteor shower over the Atlantic Ocean, and that was in November 13, 1833. So all this stuff has already happened, but the fulfillment of this prophecy in Revelation 6, 12, and 14 led to a series of revivals and to the realization that Christ's second coming was near.
Well, see, that just is giving you all these things are really happening.
Yes.
That tells you how close we are to Jesus coming back.
Mm-hmm.
If all these things have already went by and happened, well,
it's
man,
really
we're close now. Yeah, we're right at the door.
Right at the door.
Of Jesus coming back. These things have already come to pass. Well, we definitely don't have a lot of time to be playing around and wasting time thinking that we got forever.
That's correct.
Because a lot of time have already gone by.
Has already gone by. Definitely are in the last days.
In the last days.
That's right. She said, even at the door. So as we see all these signs and all these things is happening in the earth, even as of today, with the earthquakes and hurricanes and the weather, all these things, and all these mass shootings, all those or what, it is letting us know that Jesus is coming back and we need to be ready.
Yeah, he said, for my children go on, will not let these things trouble you.
That's correct.
Well, these are just signs that I am still coming back to get you.
Amen.
But he's going to still hold true to his promise.
That's right.
That he said when he left that he will be back
to receive you unto himself.
And he said he was coming from the east.
That's
so
right.
Don't let nobody tell you he's coming from the west. He's coming from the north.
And he will not touch the ground.
And
he will not touch the ground.
So how could somebody tell you that? Oh, Jesus is going to be over there in Murfreesboro. Jesus is going to be in Ducon, or he's going to be in St. Louis. He already told you he will not touch this filthy, dirty, polluted, corrupt ground.
He said we will be caught up to meet him in the air.
Right.
Amen.
So he already warned his people what's going to happen when he come back. So you don't have to worry about being misled
or deceived
when he's already told you how it's going to be when he comes back.
That's right. And we're going to go back to Revelation 6.
Okay.
15, 16, and 17. Revelation 6, 15, 16, and 17. So then the kings of the earth and their noblemen and their magnates and their military chiefs and the wealthy and the strong and everyone, whether slave or free, hide themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountain. And they called to the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the deep-seated indignation and wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath, vengeance, retribution, indignation has come, and who is able to stand before it? Also, we can go to Isaiah 2:19 in the Old Testament.
Chapter 2, verse 19. Let it go.
Then shall the stricken, deprived of all in which they had trusted, go into the caves of the rocks, into the holes of the earth, from before the terror and the dread of the Lord, and from before the glory of his majesty, when he arises to shake mightily the terrible of the earth. And so we can also look at that in Hosea, that will be chapter 10 and verse 8. It's chapter 10 and verse 8.
Okay, there you go.
The high places also of Avim, once Bethel, house of God, now Bethel, house of idolatry, the sin of Israel, shall be destroyed. The thorn and the thistles shall come up on their idol altars, and they shall say to the mountains, cover us, and to the hills, fall on us. Again, what is he saying? So, and those two are in the Old Testament. Then we'll take you all the way back to Luke chapter 23 in the New Testament. Luke chapter 23 and verse 30. Okay. Then they will begin to say to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. So the scenes portray people of all walks of life in a panic, trying to hide from the terror of the upheaval at the coming of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
That's what all that is talking about, from the old, from Isaiah, Hosea, all the way to the New Testament. Yep. They are all telling the story.
They're all trying to hide. All different nationalities, all different cultures are trying to do what?
Hide from the coming of Christ.
That's right. Because they know. They know now.
They know
that
now.
There is no way that they can be saved because, the doors are closed.
That's it.
The doors are closed.
Has closed.
The mountain, the God have closed everything. There's no salvation now. Is everything been shut down? See, so now and down they're running, trying to hide
from the terror of the upheaval because of Christ coming.
Because of Christ coming, they know he's getting ready to come back. They saying mountains set
and the rocks.
Set. The rocks
follow me, cover me, protect me.
And they say, I got to prepare a place for myself. I ain't got time to sit on you. I ain't got time to hide you. I'm trying to find somewhere to put myself. It's over with.
That's
it's
right.
Over and done. See?
Again, like you said, it's over and done. They are asking the rocks and the mountains to cover them in order to protect them from the face of him who sits on the throne. We're going to go to Revelation chapter 6.
Okay, Revelation chapter 6.
And 16.
Okay, there we are, 16.
And they call to the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the deep-seated indignation and wrath of the Lamb. So the time has arrived for justice to be dispensed as Christ comes to be glorified in his saints.
Well, what do you say? If you haven't been changed over, transformed,
right.
His face will destroy you. It would disintegrate you.
Yes, it would.
Because he told Moses, he said Moses wanted to see his face. Well, he said, tell you what, Moses, you can't handle this. Look at me directly in my face. I'm going to just put it on you like that.
Let you see my hinder parts.
Yeah.
But you got to hide behind that tree.
Yeah, because he said, Moses, you can't handle this thing looking at me straight, you know. So you have to watch me, and you hide over behind that tree. And when I go around this rock, you see my behind part, but you can't check me out looking me straight in the face.
Because of his glory.
His glory.
That's right.
And that's what is going to destroy them is God's glory.
That's it.
And this is why they run and saying, hey,
mountains
and the rocks. Sit on me. Rocks,
hide me.
Cover me. Hide me. Because God's glory is like disintegrating them, like cigarette ashes.
Wow.
You out of here. See what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
See, because it's over with. Ain't no forgiveness. Ain't no begging for mercy. Mercy gone. Mercy done. Got his suitcase, packed it up, put his clothes in it, caught the next thing smoking. you do. You ain't nothing happening now.
That's right.
See?
And that's what we got to understand. We are at that time. But before we go on, we're going to go ahead and take a break.
Okay.
And talk some more about these seven seals. But we want you to keep it locked in on LPJ 64 for Mr. and Mrs. Sweet Thing Bible Study Hour.
Themselves and pray. Oh, pray and believe that there was
If you have just joined us, you are listening to L.P.J. 64 with Mr. and Mrs. Sweetthing Bible Study Hour.
And
we're talking about the seven seals.
Well, I'm just telling you, we're so happy to have them tonight with us and sharing the word with us. It's just nice to be able to get together. And God said, where shall two or more gather in my name? On the same accord.
That's right.
We are in the midst. And
he's in the midst.
And he's there with us.
That's right.
That's right. That's right.
So we're talking about the seven seals. And we're going to go into Revelation chapter 19, verse 17 through 21.
Okay. I got it. I'm ready.
Okay. Then I saw a single angel stationed in the sun's light. And with a mighty voice, he shouted to all the birds that fly across the sky, come, gather yourself together for the great supper of God, that you may feast on the flesh of the rulers, the flesh of the generals and captains, the flesh of the powerful and mighty men, the flesh of the horses and their riders, the flesh of all humanity, both free and slave, both small and great. Then I saw the beast and the rulers and the leaders of the earth with their troops mustered to go into battle and make war against him who was mounted on the horse and against his troops. And the beast was seized and overpowered, and with him the false prophet who in his presence had worked wonders and performed miracles by which he led astray those who had accepted or permitted to be placed upon them the stamp or the mark of the beast, and those who paid homage and gave divine honors to his statue. Both of them were hurled alive into the fiery lake that burns and blazes with brimstones, and the rest were killed with the sword that issues from the mouth of him who is mounted on a horse, and all the birds fed ravenously and glutted themselves with their flesh. Mm. I do not want to be those that did not accept the love of God, or the love of his word.
Well, the love of the truth.
When you accept
the love of the truth, then you have accepted God. And if you don't accept the love of the truth, then you have accepted
the mark of the beast.
That's what it is. It's not 666. It's not a chip in the hand. It's not all that crap. Satan wants you to believe that.
But you need to study so you know the truth, right, and not be deceived.
The mark of the beast is not accepting and loving the truth
of his word. Amen.
Of his word. And that is turning away from Jesus, not accepting Jesus.
And being obedient unto his word.
That's right.
His commandments.
So when you don't accept Jesus, then you accept who?
You accept the devil himself and the liar, the father of it.
The father of it, and that's the beast, the devil. That's how you get the mark of the beast, by turning down the truth.
That's right.
Then you are accepting the mark of the beast,
which will be the great day of his wrath. Who is able to stand? So, and that's in Revelation 6:17.
Yeah, that's what it, because it all started out at the beginning. The biggest war it was in heaven.
Sure was.
And it was all about worship.
That's right.
It was all about worship then.
And it's still about worship today.
And it will be about worship at the end.
Choose you this day who you will serve.
That's right. So if you want to choose the right master, choose now. And then at the end, you won't have to worry about.
Because whatever you choose, you got right now to do it.
That's right. Right now, not tomorrow, not next year. Because people are leaving here so fast.
Wow.
Let me tell you, what we don't realize is what you die and go to the grave with on your mind, if it's porno, sex, another man's wife, murder, whatever you die and go to the grave with on your mind,
that's
the Bible tells me you're going to awaken with that same thing on your mind. That's what's going to send you to hell.
That's right. So you need to stay in the Word. So as you continue to surrender every day. So that's why it's a progress. That's why you need to start now. So through the days and the trials and tribulations of your life, you can grow in Christ.
Yeah, because I can remember when I was coming up, people used to have the old saying, I'll die and go to my grave where nobody know it but me.
Mm. Yeah. Oh. Yeah, those words will come back to bite you for real.
Yes. Yes. So I don't think you really want that to be.
You don't.
Them old sayings, they used to say in those days when I was young, I used mm-hmm. to hear.
I did too.
I used to hear men say, I'll die and go to my grave, and won't nobody know but me and Jesus. Okay.
And it will be played right back to you in front of the entire universe.
Yes. And when Jesus comes to the clouds and blow that trumpet and you wake up and that same old piece of junk is on your mind and you see yourself on the way to hell because you awakened with the same sin that you had when you went into your grave and you lose your soul for that same sin, don't say, uh-oh, Lord, forgive me, be too late. So we need to get together right now.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to repent right now and say, Lord, help me.
That's right.
Forgive me for my sin and forgive me for those that I don't remember I did that's been in the past and forgive me for anything that I've done now and forgive me for anything that is not holy and forgive me for anything that does not give you the glory.
That's right.
Ask him, and he'll do it.
Yes, he will.
Okay.
And those things you really have to give to God and let him work in and through your life. It's an everyday progress.
Yes. Well, that's why it's an everlasting progress to your grave.
That's right. That's why you grow in Christ, grow in grace. You be justified, sanctified from glory to glory.
God loves us and he don't want any of us to perish. That's why he went to the cross, because he wanted us to have the opportunity to make it in.
That's right. So we're going to go to the Old Testament again and Nahum. That's N-A-H-U-M. Chapter 1, verse 6.
Okay.
Who can stand before his indignation? Who can abide in the fierceness of his anger? His fury is poured out like fire, and the rocks are thrown down by him. Let's go up to verse 5.
Okay.
The mountains quake at him, and the hills melt, and the earth is burned at his presence.
Mm.
Yea, the world and all that dwell therein.
Now, Jesus have fixed it. He have got it already fixed. Well, this don't even have to pertain to you at all.
Right.
He fixed it by giving you salvation if you want it.
And it's free.
And it's free. Don't cost you not one dime.
Because he already paid the price.
He went to the cross and paid the price. He said, now, salvation and it's free. Mm-hmm. Doesn't cost you anything.
That's right.
All you gotta do is repent
and accept
and believe
by faith.
Now,
and you don't have to worry about all of that when he comes.
Right. Now, what more could you want for someone to do for your soul than that?
Amen. Amen.
Now, I couldn't think of anything else I could ask for anybody to do for me than to buy me a house the color, kind of carpet, how many rooms I want, furnish it like I want it,
right.
give me a key to it and tell me to move it. That's just what Jesus did.
Yes, he did.
That's just what he did. When he went to the cross for our salvation, he made everything right just like we needed it. Not wanted, but needed.
That's right.
Okay, I know you're ready to move on a bit. Go ahead.
Oh, we're going to Malachi.
Malachi.
Chapter 3.
Malachi. Okay, here we go. Last one right there.
Malachi chapter 3 and verse 2.
Okay.
But who may abide the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appeareth? For he is like a refiner's fire and like the fuller's soap. Plenty of cleaner soap. Ooh-wee.
Mm.
Amen.
Yeah, I say amen to that.
Who will be able to stand? So all it's saying is we read this, we study this, we need to be preparing so we don't have to worry about the refiner's fire because we have been cleansed, we have repented, we have surrendered our life, and we believe in the second coming of Christ.
And that's, I mean, now, what more do you need when Jesus laid out as plain as the fingers on your hand? Now, what do you need? What else do you need?
Right.
What's so hard about that? I mean, that's love.
That's love.
That's love. I can't see anybody saying that Jesus is not love.
He's love, every bit of it.
No, I can't see you not understanding that. And I can't see you questioning who is Jesus.
That's right.
And if he's real, somebody had to go to the cross for you.
Sure did. Amen. So we're talking about who will be able to stand. Well, you know, that answer to that question is in Revelation chapter 7 and verse 4.
Oh, Revelation chapter 7
and verse 4. So we're saying who should be able to stand? The fiery furnace, the fiery, that when Jesus comes,
okay.
The fire, the refining fire. Like a cleaner soap.
Yes.
You know, and so in Revelation chapter 7, verse 4.
All right.
And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. So those who will be able to stand is that day, on that day, are the sealed people of God.
All right. Amen. And I want to be one of them.
I don't know about you,
but
as that song say, I want to be in that number.
That's right. Or when the saints go marching in,
mm-hmm.
I want to be in that number. That's one of them old songs. Well, that's what the young people would call it today. That's the old music. That's the old music. We don't sing that no more. Well, let me tell you what.
We need to
go back and sing it because this stuff we're singing today ain't making it.
No.
This stuff will make you pop your fingers like you're going out to the bar somewhere to have a good time.
Yeah, you're right about that.
Mm-mm.
But that's not what's important. What's important is that we prepare for the next life.
That's right.
But we got to prepare for the next life. Right here.
Let's see. That's what we have to understand. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but see, you're preparing for heaven right here on earth.
That's it. That's true.
If you don't get things right here, you're not going to heaven.
So everybody that's singing about heaven ain't going.
That's right. You know, when you prepare for a doctor, you don't go to the hospital and be a doctor first, do you?
Nope, you got to go through some years of schooling.
And then you got to go through
your internship.
Internship. But see, that's the way it is in heaven. You doing your internship right here.
That's right.
If you want to get in heaven, you got to pass it here.
Years of schooling.
That's right.
An intern. And one day.
And one day,
the glory of God is going to appear to come back and get us.
And he's going to bring your degree with him.
That's right. Amen.
And if you don't pass here, you get your flop. You get a big old F. What the F stand for? Failure.
Failure. That's right.
That's what it stands for. Failure. Okay, let's go.
That's exactly right. You know, the book of Revelation picks up and expands beautifully this same theme. And thus, Revelation is not by any means some sort of offbeat apocalypse that is out of tune with biblical literature in general. It conveys the very heart and the substance of biblical messages. So indeed, as Revelation emphatically points out, the living one, the one who conquered death and the grave and will never forsake his faithful followers, and that even when they suffer mortal, they are victorious. Amen. And amen, with the crown of life awaiting them. So that's what we got to remember. If you study in Revelation and ask the Holy Spirit to lead you, Holy Spirit leads you to all truth.
Well, you know, that's why Jesus left that. He said, again, I've got to go. And I got to leave y'all. I got to go away. I got to go on a little trip. And I'm going to be gone for a little while. But let me tell you something.
I'll send you a comforter.
I'm going to send y'all something. I'm not going to leave y'all hanging all by yourself with nothing to guide you and lead you and keep you on the right track. I'm going to send you
a comforter.
A comforter.
Which is the Holy Spirit.
Which is the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit is what seals us, his people, for when he come back.
That's right. And that means he left the Holy Spirit on earth. That tells you what? You need to get it right here first.
That's right.
Or he would have let the Holy Spirit somewhere else. That means you would have to go where the Holy Spirit is at. But the Holy Spirit was left here with us.
And so you need to be seeking. You need to be. You need to be asking, seeking, and knocking.
Right, right here on earth, getting it right to go to your permanent home.
Amen.
You know.
And so, you know, we thank you tonight that we finished up the Seven Seals, which was part two. And we just want to let you know, you continue to seek God, continue to stay in his word, that you may continue to grow in grace.
Amen.
Amen. So we'll come back with closing comments. We're going to play a song, and we will come back and give you our email address. So keep it locked in on LPJ 64 with Mr. and Mrs. Sweet Thing Bible Study Hour.
One of these mornings, it won't be long. You'll look for me, and I'll be gone. Just walk around,
walk around.
My mother will be waiting.
group. They've been around a long time. Love them, I tell you. I love them. And that's my song, Walk Around in
Heaven All Day.
I'm telling you, I'm looking forward to doing that. Walking around heaven all day. Long.
Amen. So we want to thank you for joining us.
Yeah, we want to thank you all for joining us, and we'll be back again here.
We'll be back again Monday.
Monday.
9 p.m. to 10 p.m. right here on L.P.J. 64 Bible
and
Study Hour.
Be here, because I'll tell you, if you miss the Bible study, you're going to miss a... We shoot it straight. We ain't got no other way to do it but shoot it straight.
Straight truth.
God said
Straight testimony.
I can't cut it short, can't cut it off, because I'll be responsible. God said, He that mislead one of my little ones.
Might as well put brimstone around their neck and jumping.
Mississippi River. That's what he said. You mislead one. I can't do it tell you the truth. Even though sometimes it cuts me on the bottom of my feet. Because I know what I need to do. But I still got to let you know. It ain't right.
That's right. So we just want to thank you for joining us right here on L.P.J. 64 with Mr. and Mrs. Sweet Thing, and our closing comments will be Revelation chapter 1 and verse 18. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. So remember that. Choose life, because Christ is alive forevermore. So we'll come back. We're going to have prayer. We'll now come back and give you our email address. So keep it locked in on LPJ 64.
A mind to pray. Dear Almighty and Omnipotent God, our Father, our Creator, and everlasting help, we humbly approach your throne in the precious name of Jesus. We eagerly enter your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise, recognizing you are infinite in power and might. The fullness of your ways are past knowing, and your majesty is both seen and felt. Your word says you will grant us the very desire and will to do those things that are pleasing in your sight. In the name of Jesus, the first and the last, we ask for our mind to pray and revelation to have a deeper and more intimate fellowship with you. We ask that you drive out all distractions and the cares of this life and give us a sincere heart to seek your face with great expectation and hope. Let us have the same attitude of Christ, who was totally faithful and dependent on you. In the name of Jesus, help us, Holy Spirit, to submit our minds to the purpose and plans of God while teaching us how to follow him daily. Let us turn from our wicked ways so that our sins be forgiven and that you hear our prayers and restore our land. In the name of Jesus, renew our minds and saturate them in your word, that our thoughts are pure and steadfastly focused on you. Draw us near and let us listen attentively to your voice, cherishing every moment in prayer and fellowship with you. Let us desire your presence more than our natural food, and give us a mind to pray and seek your kingdom above all else, while trusting you to provide all of our needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen.
Amen. And may the windows of heaven open and pour upon you a bundle of blessings. Happy Sabbath, and don't forget, come back Monday from 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. And if you have any questions, Bible questions, or you need prayer, you can email us at robtgina50@gmail.com. And have a blessed night.
Yeah, have a blessed night. And don't be ashamed. If you need prayer, send that email. I need prayer. You pray for me. I ain't ashamed to ask.
Yeah, we love to pray, so we don't have a problem with that at all.
So have
a blessed night.
Have a blessed night.